the book of 1 Corinthians, because this is when the Corinthian church is established in Acts chapter 18. And Paul is pretty clear in 1 Corinthians that he's the one who establishes the church at Corinth. But we're moving into this last section of Paul's European journey that began in chapter 15 and verse 35, and it is the first record of the gospel coming to Europe. Now, that's not to say that there weren't missionaries that came, but we don't see any churches planted until Paul comes. Paul comes and he plants churches. But we're going to be introduced today to two people, Aquila and Priscilla, who seem to already know Christ when Paul meets them. And it seems almost like a seeking out of them, if we understand the reading of the text. And they're, interestingly enough, having come just freshly from Italy. And so it's possible that they came as missionaries, doing work and just talking about Jesus as they went along. But as we see this final passage, in Europe, this is the second of Paul's missionary journeys, we see that he has been in two provinces, and Corinth is the fifth city on this journey in which he establishes a church. The first province that he went into was Macedonia, and he established churches in Philippi and Thessalonica and Berea. The ministry in Macedonia was difficult at best for him, but the Lord brought fruit out of those churches. Then we see he moves into Achaia, a little bit further south on the Grecian peninsula, and he moves into Athens, and he preaches in Athens. And there is not a great response in Athens, but yet there is a response. There are converts, but there is not a great or overwhelming response. But that all changes as we come into Corinth. And Corinth is actually the most fruitful on the missionary journey, and it's the one that has the least opposition that Paul actually deals with. Yes, he deals with opposition here, but it's not as concentrated. I mean, remember, he's essentially run out of Philippi. He's run out of Thessalonica. He's spirited away from Berea. And in Athens, he meets resistance. But now he comes into Corinth, and as we consider Corinth, we see that he is going to be given the freedom by the Lord to establish a church there that becomes, in Paul's mind, a functioning church. Now, there are some critics and commentators who give Paul a hard time because he left Corinth and then he so quickly had to write to Corinth. But we know more about Corinth than we do any other church in the New Testament, because we have two rather lengthy letters that Paul has written to them. So in our canon of Scripture, we have the most information about this city, Corinth, and we're dealing with it on Sundays through our series. But we feel that Paul most likely arrived in Corinth in either February or March, and we date this because of some statements that are made about him having to make it back to Jerusalem to celebrate the feast. And so we just gather from that that's about the time that he would have been there, and we presume that it was somewhere around AD 50 that he arrives, because of a little statement that's made in this passage. Now, we want to begin to consider these six events in Corinth and see how far the Lord gets us. We'll just read the first four verses, and we'll deal with the first event that happens. After these things, Paul departed from Athens and came to Corinth, and found a certain Jew named Aquila, born in Pontus, lately come from Italy with his wife Priscilla, because that Claudius had commanded all Jews to depart from Rome and came unto them. And because he was of the same craft, he abode with them and wrought, for by their occupation they were tent makers. And he reasoned in the synagogue every Sabbath and persuaded the Jews and the Greeks. Just a brief prayer. Our Father, we pray that you would help us as we approach the text this evening. May we be able to see just the joy that you give to Paul in giving him comfort and encouragement after such a difficult journey that he's had so far. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Paul comes to Corinth. And there are some, you've always got to be careful with this, I remember a chapter in one of Ralph Davis's books. He's written so many books, and I appreciate his writing. But in one of them, he has a chapter title that asks this question: will the psychoanalysts win? We've always got to be careful that we don't try to read ourselves and how we would feel in certain situations back into the text and call that the canon of Scripture. What I'm saying is we can't look at this and we can't say, well, on the heels of all of this defeat, Paul is probably pretty discouraged when he walks into Corinth. We don't know that. The text doesn't state that. Paul knew what he was getting into. In Paul's call, what is a part of Paul's call was sent to him? Yeah.
A.
Huh? Yeah, I know it begins with an A, but I can't think of it. Anyway, when he's sent to him, and he goes down in chapter 9, and he begins to talk with Paul, it'll come to me. Why don't I just look? Because it'll be right there in the text. Paul is Ananias. Yeah, the good Ananias. And so I kept thinking Agabus, and I'm thinking, no, that's the one who wraps him in the girdle. But Ananias goes down to Paul, and the Lord tells Ananias what? He says, tell him what great things he must suffer for my name's sake. So Paul knew that this would be his ministry. Now, we also have to be careful and not think that Paul was the Ubermensch, the Superman, that somehow he did not feel the effects of the slights that he receives, and even greater than slights that he receives in his ministry. But yet the Lord is faithful to his servants. I was just reading a biography on a man, and the question was asked him, what's the hardest, he has an online ministry presence, and he said, they asked him, what's the hardest thing that you have to deal with an online ministry presence? And he said, using a very Gen Z word, he said, all the haters. Because you realize on the internet, everybody is convinced that their opinion matters. And so he said, that's the difficulty that I have to deal with, is everybody saying how terrible I am, or how I've gotten this wrong, or how I've gotten that wrong. And he says, when that happens, I go and I read the testimonies of all the people who have been helped by the ministry. And sometimes we have to do that. In ministry as a pastor, it's very easy as you're walking through this world, it's very easy to get down. I talked with my brother-in-law on Monday, and I said to him, so do you have your resignation filled out yet? Because that's the running joke amongst pastors, is that every pastor has his resignation filled out and ready to go on Monday morning to turn it into the church. He just doesn't sign it. And there's some truth to that, that there is that letdown that happens. But we've got to remember that our Lord is faithful to his servants as well. And where we see difficulties, the Lord also brings alongside of us blessings and fruitfulness. And Paul experiences this in these two unique people, Aquila and Priscilla. They're two of the most mentioned people in New Testament Scripture. We don't know really a great deal about them, but we know that they uniquely ministered to Paul. And when Paul arrives at Corinth, you can almost sense in the fact, now Aquila and Priscilla would not have been elite. This is not a Lydia situation where Lydia has her own house and Lydia has apparently a great deal of money just from her profession. Rather, they would have been day laborers, hard workers, who were artisans and craftsmen who were able to work on tents and sometimes, you know, you might be able to read that word as leather workers. But the idea that is given to us here is that they were fairly poor people, and there was a particular section of Corinth that was set apart for people who worked like that. And it's most likely, one author wrote, that Priscilla and Aquila probably slept upstairs in a little tiny shop, and Paul probably slept downstairs with all the tools. And that was the arrangement that set up. But yet you can sense in this, as you're reading it, you can sense that Paul finds this camaraderie here. And Aquila and Priscilla allow Paul to be able to be what he is, a tent maker. And Paul begins his work in Corinth as a bivocational minister. And he doesn't make, and he makes this plain, we'll get to that when we get to it in Corinthians. He makes it plain that he doesn't make the Corinthians chargeable for his work when he first comes. Now, his work gets easier because Timothy and Silas are going to come and join him, and they're going to bring with them an offering from the Macedonian churches that are going to allow Paul to be able to minister. So that's where we get the concept. If you've ever wondered why we do what we do with missionaries, why is it that we send money to missionaries? Well, we send it to them so that we are not making the people who are first hearing the gospel chargeable for hearing the gospel. And then we do it so that we can support those men so that they can be dedicated to the work of the gospel while they're there. Now, the idea is never for that to be an ongoing thing. That's one of the issues that we're dealing with the Filipino church, is this concept that people just think that it should be an ongoing thing, that, you know, we're missionaries to the Filipinos and our people are poor, and so Americans ought to give us money so that we can just keep having the work go. But listen, for a church to be a church, it has to be able to support its pastor. And so there has to reach a point in every church where they say, we're not a missionary church, we are a church. And we will support our pastor, and we will sacrifice to ensure that our pastor is able to live and work in the gospel. But this is where the concept of our missionary work comes from. And so what we see is Paul arrives in Corinth, and he makes this connection with Aquila and Priscilla, and he begins to do his tent-making work in order that he might also be able to go and live and preach while he's there in Corinth. What do we know about Aquila and Priscilla? From here in the text, we know that Aquila is born in Pontus. Pontus is a province in Asia Minor, which is today Turkey. And the province is actually the province that sits right on the southern end of the Black Sea. So it's a pretty remote area. But yet in Acts 2, we see that there are people from Pontus who are in Jerusalem, Jews who are in Jerusalem, and who receive the gospel while they're there in Acts chapter 2 at the birth of the church. Now, whether Aquila is somehow connected with that, that's all hypothetical, but yet it's interesting to me that he comes from Pontus, he is a believer, and eventually he moves from his area in Pontus to Italy. While he's in Italy, he seems to meet his wife, Priscilla, and he marries her. But then he is kicked out of Italy because he is not a natural-born Roman citizen, but rather he's from Pontus. And the emperor at the time gives a decree, and this is around about AD 49 that he gives this decree, and he says all Jews have to leave because they are getting complaints from the synagogue leaders about a certain man named Crestus. Now, most people believe that that is just a corruption in the Roman language of Christ, and that there were waves that were already being felt in AD 49 up in Rome in regards to Jesus and his ministry there. So this is who we meet, and this is who Paul begins to stay with. Now, in verse 4, what does Paul do? Paul does what Paul does. He goes to the synagogue, and it says he reasoned in the synagogue every Sabbath and persuaded the Jews and the Greeks. Now, we do not see that he's given that position of being given open freedom to speak, but yet he is given the position where he's able to go and reason with the Jews that are there and talk with them. Now, the second instance that we see happen is in verses 5 to 8. And when Silas and Timotheus were come from Macedonia, Paul was pressed in the spirit and testified to the Jews that Jesus was Christ. And when they opposed themselves and blasphemed, he shook his raiment and said unto them, your blood be upon your own heads. I am clean from henceforth. I will go unto the Gentiles. And he departed thence and entered into a certain man's house named Justus, one that worshipped God, whose house joined hard to the synagogue. And Crispus, the chief ruler of the synagogue, believed on the Lord with all his house, and many of the Corinthians, hearing, believed and were baptized. So now we see, not only does God encourage Paul with the relationship that he has with Aquila and Priscilla, but he also encourages Paul by seeing converts that come to the gospel of Jesus Christ. He reasons with them, and I think it is safe to read the text this way. In verse 4, it talks about Paul laying the groundwork. So he is reasoning with them from the scriptures. I take that to mean that Paul is specifically going to the messianic texts in the Old Testament, and he is saying, what do you think about this messianic text? What do you think about this messianic text? You know, I presume that he took the people there to the passages in Isaiah. I presume he went to Isaiah 53. I presume that he went to Daniel and talked about the Son of Man. I presume that he went to the Psalms that speak specifically about the Messiah who will come. And I think that he intentionally does this. He most likely even took them back to the law and said, look, what do you think the seed of promise is in Genesis chapter 3? And I believe he takes them through and he establishes the concept of the Messiah. But then when Timothy and Silas come, he's given the freedom at this point. We know from reading Corinthians, he's given the freedom that he's able to not focus on the tent making anymore, but focus on the ministry. And he switches gears and he puts it into another gear, so to speak. And he says, all of this talk about the Messiah, Jesus is him. And this is the proof. Now, when he does this, this has an immediate effect. The Jews want to talk about Messiah until you say to them, it's Jesus. Once you say, it's Jesus, now all of a sudden you have labeled Messiah, and now they have to make a choice, because remember we said there is no neutrality when it comes to approaching Jesus. It's either you receive him or you reject him. There is no neutrality. So, he presents to them Jesus, and as he presents to them Jesus, he receives opposition from them in verse 6. They oppose themselves and blasphemed. Now, what that means is that they spoke ill of Paul himself. They blasphemed Paul. And Paul's response is to do what? He shakes his raiment. And he says, your blood be upon your own heads. He's saying, I am free. I have done my responsibility. My responsibility was to tell you about Jesus. I cannot coerce you into receiving Jesus. And he shakes his raiment or his robes, and he says, all the blasphemies that you have brought against me, they're gone, because I've been faithful in my ministry to Jesus Christ. That's important. So that's his reaction to the opposition. Well, then what happens? There's a man named Titus who receives Jesus Christ. And they go Titus Justus. They go to Titus Justus's house, and they stay with him in verse 7. And he departed thence and entered into this certain man's house. And then this house, incidentally, is right beside the synagogue. And it's like the Lord is saying, I'm not going to remove my witness too far from my people. Because, remember, God is still interested in his people. This is my position and the position of this church. God has not replaced Israel with the church. He is still interested in his people. We recognize for this point in history that God's program is now with his people, the church, as opposed to with his people, Israel. But God has not replaced them. So, they go into Titus's house, and we have a very significant conversion in verse 8. A man named Crispus, who is the chief ruler of the synagogue. This is a guy of great authority. This is the man who would set the agenda for how things go. He's the one that wrote the bulletin for the synagogue. And he determined how things were going to happen and what was going to go on. And he's the one who is converted. And then it says this, And many of the Corinthians, so we recognize Paul in his writings to 1 Corinthians, we recognize in 1 Corinthians 1 that he is writing to both Jews and Gentiles. And so he writes, and he's writing to the Gentiles as well, because the Gentiles are redeemed as well. In verse 8, many Corinthians hearing believed and were baptized. How did they hear? We're not sure of this, but we know that Paul's pattern was to go into the agora or the forum, and he was to talk with the people there. That's his modus operandi. That's how Paul operates. He goes from place to place, and he speaks to both Jew and Gentile in both their public forum settings, the synagogues, the agoras, the forums. So then we have a third event that happens, and this is a visionary encouragement. Now, I want to remind you guys of this key truth when you're studying the book of Acts. When you read the book of Acts, you have to remember not everything in the book of Acts is prescriptive. There are some things in the book of Acts that are descriptive. What's the difference between prescriptive and descriptive? Well, if I give you a prescription, what do I want you to do? I want you to do it. Whereas if I'm describing something for you, I'm not saying go and do this and continue doing this. I'm merely describing it for you. And so I believe that we have to approach these verses in verses 9 to 11, and we have to recognize Paul is a unique person. Why? Because he is an apostle. This is an unreplaceable position in the church. And as in this unique position that he holds as the apostle, he has a word of encouragement that comes to him by a vision. And it says, "Then spake the Lord to Paul in the night by a vision," in verse 9, "Be not afraid, but speak, and hold not thy peace. For I am with thee, and no man shall set on thee to hurt thee. For I have much people in this city." And he continued there a year and 6 months, teaching the word of God among them. I don't believe that Dr. Luke is writing this so that everybody can say, "Well, Lord, I just need a vision from you to help me feel better about how things are going." That's not his intent. I think that Dr. Luke is just writing this because this is what happened. He's describing it. This is Paul. This is the Apostle Paul. This is not Nathan Bramlett. This is not Jeff Renwick or Bob Laird. This is the Apostle Paul. And the Lord has a unique relationship with the Apostle Paul that he does not have with us, in the sense that he has given him a foundational role in the church. So that, and we'll see this when we get back into Corinthians, we'll see that Paul's word is as legitimate as Christ's word. Did you hear that? Paul's word is as legitimate as Christ's word, because effectively it is Christ's word that has been given through the Apostle Paul. So, Paul is in a unique position, but he is also given this encouragement from the Lord. Now, it's from these verses that people guess that Paul maybe needed this encouragement. Now, we're not told that. We're not expressly told why the Lord gives him this encouragement. But we can see something in this of the nature of our God. Our God delights to encourage his servants. And we see this in the encouragement that came from Aquila and Priscilla. We see this in the encouragement that came from Justice, whose house the Lord gave to them so that they could meet in. We see this in the encouragement of many converts. We see this in the encouragement of the conversion of Crispus. And we see this in the encouragement of God himself giving a vision to the Apostle Paul. So the Lord appears in verse 9. The road to Corinth was not an easy road. Paul has experienced many trials and tribulations, many beatings, many sufferings. But he arrives here and the Lord says, "This isn't going to be the place where you're going to experience that, Paul. Here I have set a door open for you." And as a result of that, Paul stays. So the Lord gives Paul a promise. The promise that he gives to Paul is that he will give his presence to him, that he will give his protection to him, and that he will give success to him. And Paul's ministry is a fruitful ministry. And it goes on for a year and a half. This is one of the longer, we should never presume that Paul just showed up at a place, preached one sermon, and then went on. But yet here we're specifically told that he spends 18 months in the city of Corinth before he moves on and goes back. So then we have the fourth event that happens. Paul is accused, and this is in verses 12 to 17. And when Gallio was the deputy of Achaia, the Jews made insurrection with one accord against Paul and brought him into the judgment seat, saying, "This fellow persuadeth men to worship God contrary to the law." And when Paul was now about to open his mouth, Gallio said unto the Jews, "If it were a matter of wrong or wicked lewdness, O ye Jews, reason would that I should bear with you. But if it be a question of words and names and of your law, look ye to it, for I will be no judge of such matters." And he drave them from the judgment seat. Then all the Greeks took Sosthenes, the chief ruler of the synagogue, and beat him before the judgment seat. And Gallio cared for none of these things. So the Corinthian Jews get upset, and they bring their case before Gallio. And as they bring their case before Gallio, Paul is ready to defend himself, but Paul doesn't have to defend himself. Gallio stands up and says, "Listen, this is a matter of you guys having some sort of tick in your law that you're just not dealing with as you should with each other." And he says, "I don't even want to hear it. I'm not going to get into," basically, this is his way of saying, "I'm not going to get into a religious argument." If this were a political argument, if this were something to do with insurrection, if this were something to do with wicked lewdness, he said, some sort of gross public immorality, then I'd deal with it. But it's a matter of who your Messiah is, so you deal with it. Now, this has a reaction. The Greeks become irritated. Now, we can only presume that this is on the heel of the anti-Semitic feeling that's already going through the emperor as, or the empire, as the emperor has said, you know, Jews have to get out of Rome. And so there's 40 to 50,000 Jews that are living in Rome that are now dispersed back into the empire. And Corinth is a major city. And so we see that there has to be a connection there. This is what we can gather in reading this. And so the end result is the guy who replaces Crispus, because obviously they kick Crispus out because Crispus is gone with Paul. And the guy who replaces him is this guy named Sosthenes. And so they take Sosthenes, who would have been the man who would have brought the case to Gallio. The Greeks take him and they beat him. Now, incidentally, in 1 Corinthians chapter 1, there's a Sosthenes that's mentioned as one of the ones receiving the letter. If this is the same guy, what a beautiful grace that the Lord gives to Sosthenes, that the man who's beaten for opposing the gospel would come under the gospel. It's a beautiful thing to think about. Now, it can only be conjecture because Sosthenes is not an uncommon name in Greece. So then the fifth event that happens is that Paul is free to continue his missionary work. How does he continue it? In verse 18, "And Paul, after this, tarried there yet a good while, and then took his leave of the brethren, and sailed thence into Syria, and with him Priscilla and Aquila." Then it says this statement. So that's the fifth event, is Paul continues his missionary work. Then the sixth event that happens is Paul returns to Ephesus, Jerusalem, and finally Antioch. And there's this little thing that happens here that is interesting. It says at the end of verse 18, "having shorn his head in Cenchrea, for he had a vow." That's all Luke tells us. So you could ask me, "Now, Pastor, why does he do this?" And I could give you my opinion, but I can't give you a concrete answer as to why Paul does this. Is this Paul's way of saying that he still is a conservative Orthodox Jew? Is he performing a Nazarite vow? It's quite possible. But the scriptures don't tell us that. We would have to draw that assumption. All we can say is that for some reason Luke records this. What's the reason for the vow? We don't know. Is he asking for safe journey? Is he asking for success? Is, you know, because the Nazarite vow is, you know, an if-then type deal. So we don't know why he does it, but we recognize that he does do it. And again, there are some parts of Scripture that are prescriptive and some that are descriptive. Does this mean, listen, shaving my head would not mean much, but, you know, is this something that is required for us to do today? I don't believe that that's what Dr. Luke is saying. I think he's just saying this is what Paul did. So then we go on and we see, what does he do? In verse 9, he came to Ephesus and left them there, but he himself entered into the synagogue and reasoned with the Jews. When they desired him to tarry longer time with them, he consented not. Why? Because he says in verse 21, I must by all means keep this feast that cometh in Jerusalem, but I will return again unto you, if God will. And he sailed from Ephesus. And when he had landed at Caesarea and gone up and saluted the church, he went down to Antioch. And so we see that this concludes Paul's missionary journey. Where does he wind up? Back at the church that sent him out. He goes all the way back there. And in essence, he gives a report to them of everything that he had done. This is a great missionary effort that the Lord gives to Paul. And in all of this, we are astounded, absolutely astounded at what he accomplishes through this one man and how the gospel begins to enter in and how the church is born in Europe. And we're direct results of that. And we can thank our God for the fact that the gospel did not stay hidden under a bushel, but rather it went forth. Amen? Let's pray. Our Father and our God, we thank you for this opportunity to consider these passages. Lord, they're basically informative passages, but yet we do see in them, we see the character of our God, that you would desire to give encouragement to your servant, and that you continue to do that to this day, even in the midst of our darkest and hardest hours, Lord. All we need to do is look to you, and we will find encouragement. We thank you for your grace. We thank you for blessing us. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.